In yoga poses with our arms overhead, should we instruct our yoga students to pull their shoulders down away from their ears? Or should we instruct them to relax their shoulders or to soften their shoulders or to relax their upper trapezius muscles or their upper traps, which are these muscles that live here at the top of the shoulder? So these ideas are very common in the yoga world. This idea that yes, it is important that when yoga students' arms are up, that they should relax the shoulders because it's bad if they overwork or overactivate the shoulders, etc. So that's a very prevalent attitude in the yoga world in general. So I have a feeling that you may already suspect that from my movement science-based background, when I come to yoga teaching and my perspective on things like this, I don't think that it is important or super helpful to cue yoga students to relax or pull down. You may already suspect that knowing me. But what I think is more important is not just knowing like my opinion on that, but actually why, and why I think that the dominant attitude about the shoulders up and pull the arms up and shoulders down, why I think that those ideas don't hold up to scientific scrutiny. So first of all, I just want to point out that I feel like there are two kind of broad approaches to this. One approach is that as a yoga teacher, we should always just tell all of our students, like in a group class, this cue applies to everybody in a universal way, that whenever the arms are up, maybe it's down dog, maybe it's warrior one, things like this. But this idea that just globally, we should all, when the arms are up, we should all relax or pull down, etc. So there's that approach. And then there's another approach that I've sometimes asked about, which is just like, okay, I get that maybe we don't need to use this cue as a universal cue for everybody. But what about when I see an individual student and I see that they are overactivating or overstraining? What about then? Like, can I give them a cue that asks them to relax then? So that's this other question of like, okay, maybe not on a group level, but what about on an individual level? When I see it, can I correct it? So that's kind of like the main two approaches that I tend to see about this. So when we're talking about like unpacking a claim to question it and to see like whether or not it might hold up to scrutiny, I think that really the best way that I've found to do this is to just start asking questions. Because when we start to ask questions about the claim, that can often lead us to pretty quickly realizing that there either are really good reasons to support the claim, and yes, we should do that, or that there's actually a lack of support behind that claim, and maybe we should consider not making that claim. So when it comes to this whole question, my first question would be, as yoga teachers, how are we measuring whether or not a yoga student is overactivating or overstraining, overworking? How are we measuring whether this is happening in the first place? So I think this is a really good question to ask because I think we're often taught in yoga teacher trainings, like we're able to tell like how much a student is working a particular muscle, and that we can like tell that through our yoga teaching eyes. But when it comes to like actual the science of movement and muscle activation, there is a tool that's used in the laboratory called EMG or electromyography. And that's a tool where there are sensors that are placed on top of muscles that we are measuring or that are being measured. And those sensors tell the researchers, for example, or the clinicians to what extent a muscle is being activated. So muscle activation, there's like it's like a percentage, and it's based on an individual's maximum voluntary contraction or MVC. So one's MVC is like basically in just kind of rough, loose terms, it's like how hard you can activate a muscle, how like at a, what's your 100%, which would be the hardest you can activate a muscle. That's your 100%. And then EMG sensors, once you know what the 100% is, that's the MVC. EMG sensors allow you to then measure, like, well, what percent of 100 is this muscle currently at in this movement or exercise, etc. So that's like how it works. And that's all in a lab with equipment that's actually designed by science to measure muscle activation. But if we bring that back to our yoga class setting, it might start to become clear that as yoga teachers, we don't have a tool like EMG. So we actually don't have a way of measuring muscle activity. Like, we don't even know to what extent someone's muscle is activating and what percent of their MVC that is, et cetera. We can't tell that by looking with our eyes, and we cannot tell that by feeling with our fingers. Because I know sometimes yoga teachers might come around and feel your shoulders while your arms are up, and then they'll say like, oh, I could tell you're activating too much. You need to relax. But these aren't things we can feel even with our fingers. It's not something we could see visually or feel kinesthetically. It's something that's measured and tested in a lab. So I think just that right there is a really good question to realize. Take a step back and just think like, well, how are we actually measuring this in our yoga students? So then beyond that question, a couple other questions that I would have are, so say we could somehow measure muscle activation. How are we determining as yoga teachers at what point of MVC? So like what percent of someone's maximum voluntary contraction, what percent is the cutoff for where we're determining that it's abnormal or bad or incorrect? Like, what's the cutoff in the range of percentages? What is that? Do we even know? And how would we measure that someone was like above that or below that? So that's that question. And then as yoga teachers, when we suggest that someone or a whole class, we suggest that they relax their shoulders, like what's the threshold to which we want them to relax to? What percent of MVC? And is it different for every individual? Because we're all different. Our neuromuscular systems are different, et cetera, et cetera. So anyway, I know this is kind of asking a lot of questions, but I do think that just starting to unpack these claims with actual science-based questions may start to reveal that when we really look at it, some of these ideas floating out there that we just maybe have heard so many times, we start to believe them. When we actually look for the foundation or the support below them, we just start to realize it's maybe kind of shaky. So those are questions just related to how we can even assess these things in the first place. And again, just a reminder, human body is variable and how we all move is variable. So there's just that also that goes in there. Like, how could we really tell by looking at someone that they are activating too much here? And just maybe because we think it doesn't look like other people when their arms are up. But again, humans are variable. We all move in different ways. Our muscles are recruited, you know, can be differently, recruited differently and to different extents. So like, what's the baseline that we're analyzing that against if there's so much variability? Okay, so that's that. That's just like the measurement issue in the yoga world. But then my other question, I think this is also a really good question, is when we're taught, like in yoga teacher trainings, that overactivating here in the upper traps when the arms are up, we're taught that that's bad. So my question is, what negative consequences does, quote, overactivating in the upper traps, what does that cause? Like, what consequences are caused by this? And how do we know, and what research supports this? Because from my understanding of the research on such topics, we don't have research that tells us that when upper traps overactivate, when the arms are overhead, that that is something that then causes something bad, like pain or injury or things like that. I have not seen that evidence in the scientific research, that there's a causal relationship between what percent of your MVC with the arms up in the upper traps, that there's some causal connection between that and then like future pain or injury. So that is definitely like the common claim. It's just this idea, this is bad, lifting too much is bad, it's gonna cause some sort of problem. But we should ask the question like, what problems does it cause, and how do we know, and what research are we using to support that claim? And I would predict that most of the time, if you simply ask that question, there won't really be an answer, because most of us, it's super common. I do it, you do it, we all do this, but it's so easy to just parrot things that we hear out there, especially, like I said, things that are repeated over and over. We just start to maybe assume they're true without, it's just super easy to not think like, wait, maybe I should step back and actually analyze this and question it to see if it actually holds water. So that's my question, like, what problem does it even cause? And are we aware of like the current research when it comes to, in the clinical world, something called scapular dyskinesis? So again, the scapula, the shoulder blade, there are these ideas that are now kind of becoming a little outdated. These ideas that the scapula can move in abnormal ways that are connected to pain. So that would be scapular dyskinesis, like moving in a negative way, a non-optimal way. That's scapular dyskinesis. But what we actually do, so these are kind of some older ideas in, say, like the physical therapy world, the rehab world, these ideas that scapular dyskinesis is actually connected to pain and injury. But now the more and more research we have on these topics, the more we're starting to realize that there is not actually really an evidence-based connection between scapular dyskinesis and pain and injury. And I'm going to flash up here a very recent systematic review of the literature. This is a great paper to look up and read. And what these researchers did was they looked at a total, I'm going to read a little quote here, of 2,365 individuals. And they wanted to assess them for the prevalence of scapular dyskinesis. So a measurement of whether their scapulas moved quote unquote normally or quote unquote abnormally. They wanted to measure the prevalence of scapular dyskinesis among people who had shoulder pain and people who did not have shoulder pain. And not having the pain, that would be called asymptomatic. So basically what they found, looking at 2,365 subjects, that's a lot, that's like a really big sample size. What they found was that tons of people who have shoulder pain have scapulas that move quote unquote normally. They don't have scapular dyskinesis. And then they found that tons of people who are asymptomatic and have no shoulder pain at all, they're like healthy, pain-free, that they actually have scapular dyskinesis. And it was something like 48%. So about half of asymptomatic people, people with no pain, they have scapular dyskinesis. And then a large portion of people who have shoulder pain don't have scapular dyskinesis. So we're starting to see that there just really does not seem to be a connection here. This is what I wanted to read. This is the conclusion from this study. If you look it up, a considerable number of individuals with shoulder symptoms do not present with scapular dyskinesis. More revealing is the number of asymptomatic individuals who do present with scapular dyskinesis, suggesting that scapular dyskinesis may be a normal finding among nearly half of the asymptomatic population. So that is a really potent paper that I think we should read, be familiar with, and realize. And that's based on other evidence and perspectives that have also been evolving among researchers in recent years. So that's kind of like where the research-based, evidence-based perspective is on scapular movement. So all of that would cause me to sum up and suggest that when it comes to yoga and our yoga context, that when we're taught in yoga teacher trainings that we can identify like scapulas that maybe lift too high when the arms go overhead or something, and that we're thinking that that's like dyskinesis, that's like bad movement, I think that what the research is really suggesting is that doing so would be an example of pathologizing normal, because it's completely normal for the scapulas to move in different ways, and people can have them move in a way that may be labeled quote abnormal, but it's actually normal. So when we see that like almost half of everybody who doesn't even have shoulder pain has scapulas that move in a quote abnormal way, then you really have to step back and ask, does that just mean that it's normal? Is it really abnormal if it's like half of everybody? Like, is that abnormal or is that just normal? And when we want to make a problem of it as yoga teachers, are we pathologizing normal? So that's my summary as far as why I think the whole idea that as yoga teachers, it's important that we tell students to either pull down or relax, like however we word it. My perspective, my science-based perspective, is that that's not necessary, and the whole idea does not hold up to scientific scrutiny.